Penguin Random House Audio presents Tradition by Brendan Kiely. Read for you by Alex McKenna and Robbie Daymond. There's really no such thing as the voiceless. There are only the deliberately silenced or the preferably unheard. Arundhati Roy.
They hand in hand with wandering steps and slow through Eden took their solitary way. Milton, Paradise Lost. For the record, James Baxter. Most people don't get second chances. I wasn't sure I deserved one. I wasn't sure I even wanted one. But I got one. Fullbrook Academy. This is what I did with it.
Jules Devereux. I once heard another girl put it like this. This is a boys' school, and they accept girls here too. At Fullbrook, they told us to be ready to take on the world, but then they told us to do it quietly. What if I wanted to be loud? What if I needed to be? The night everything changed. Jules Devereux. I'm fighting for breath, and all I can do is look up and see the white flame of moonlight outlining each branch, every leaf. I'm in the dirt again, shoulder against the tree, the shock of air so cold it seizes my bones. I can still feel his grip on my arm, as if he's still here, shackling me to the trunk with his hands and his weight. But he's not. He's gone. I'm so cold. I'm shaking, but it feels like it's this tree and the sky above that are shaking, that are blurry, unreal, no longer what they were. It's as if I'm naked, but I'm not. It's as if the ground is swinging up to slap me, but it's not. I collapse by the edge of the bluff. There are still voices in the woods behind me, voices down along the far end of the bluff. Voices in the night air like invisible birds screeching in the wind. There's a voice inside me, too. It's mine, I think, but it doesn't sound like me. It's me, and it's not me. It grows louder and louder, barking, bellowing up from somewhere and squeezing my head with noise. It's me, and it isn't, or it's me splitting in two. And this other voice, this new voice, keeps shouting. Run, it says. Run, run, run! I'm so close to the cliff edge, I could crawl forward and drop. Crouch on one knee by the side of the pool like I did when I first learned to dive. But I'm hundreds of feet in the air, and the voice tells me to back up. I obey. It tells me to stand, and I use the tree to help me to my feet. Run, it says again. And I do. Into the woods, down the far path, away from the party, away from the other voices, away from everyone. I know where I'm going, but I still feel lost, alone. I just want to get home, though the word means nothing now. Just because I live there doesn't mean it's somewhere safe.
James Baxter. I can't believe this, but I'm so out of breath, I have to crouch down and lean against the back wall of the girls' dorm just to put some air in my lungs. Damn, it hurts. But you can't lug a passed out person through the woods, across campus, get her up through the bathroom window and not want to collapse. Even if you're me. And even if I did get some help. I know she thinks I'm an asshole, and I didn't do it to change her mind. I just did it because it was the right thing to do. And I knew it was the right thing to do, and it was the first time in a year I'd felt so certain I knew right from wrong. That I had to do the right thing and forget all the rest. If you care about a person, my ex-girlfriend used to tell me, don't just tell her. Show her. Show up, listen, and act so she knows you hurt her. Seems so simple the way she put it, but it's never that simple. An avalanche of other pressures buries that wisdom most days, all days, except this night, when, for some reason, I heard that advice, strong and true, like a wind through the eaves of the old wooden rooftop above me. Way up in the sky, the man in the moon has something like sad eyes, as if his pale face gazes down with pity, as if he wishes something better for us, or maybe wishes we ourselves were the ones who were better. I'm sure I'm sober, not drunk, just going a little crazy to think like that, but I think it anyway, because I feel that way. Sad. Like this whole stupid paradise, this very good school, is nothing but a fancy promise, a broken one, a big lie. And worse, that I'm actually a part of it. Part 1. Before. Chapter 1. James Baxter. In the mess of my first day at Fullbrook, I had one clear thought. I do not belong here. I didn't have the right clothes, the right hairstyle, the right way to speak. I didn't even know I had no clue about any of those things until I stood on the sidewalk outside my new home. Boys dorm number 3, Tapper Hall, and watched the families swirling around the residential quad. The seniors managing move-in day strolled around in their soft-toed loafers, their linen jackets and ties, relaxed and carefree, putting parents at ease with the smiles they tossed to each other across the walkways and grass. I watched, amazed, as some of the freshmen plucked those smiles out of the air and tried them on for themselves. They were naturals. Not me. I was the 18-year-old moron starting all over again at a new high school. A fifth year. Postgraduate, they call it, to be kind. Hey, one of the linen jackets said, approaching me. You must be the Buckeye. All I wanted to do was hide. But the sun was a spotlight burning down through the leaves of the tree above me. When I didn't respond, he continued. They told me you were an athlete from Ohio, he grinned. Just look at you. You got to be the Buckeye. Hey, Hackett, he yelled over his shoulder. Found the Buckeye! I tried to look natural, but I never knew what to do with my hands. That's why I'd grown up holding a stick or a ball or a dumbbell. I clasped my fingers behind my back and ended up looking like some keyed-up military man. I even had the stupid buzz cut. All these guys had hair they had to style, especially the guy walking up to us, the one called Hackett. These guys look like they flossed their teeth with the kind of money I'd make in a summer working Uncle Earl's farm. The short guy with the pit bull's bulging shoulders and flat-faced grin, and his taller friend, the shaggy-haired pretty boy, the one called Hackett. What's up? I didn't mean to sound standoffish, but I did. It comes too easy. I'm the kind of guy people expect to punch holes through walls. Not because I want to, just because I can. Freddy! The pit bull stuck out his hand. I took it. The pretty boy looked on, sleepy-eyed. Hackett, he said, without taking his hands from his pockets. Ethan Hackett. Hackett and I, Freddy continued, we've been assigned to you. All the new guys get a mentor to show them the ropes. Mostly freshmen, of course, but there are a couple of PGs this year. So, whatever, you're one of the new guys. We actually picked you, Buckeye, Hackett went on. Ha! Freddy barked. No, I got assigned to you because I play real sports, too. Hackett thinks skiing is a sport. Ignore him, Hackett said. He has a limited vocabulary. Freddy pushed Hackett, who stumbled but balanced himself quickly. See? Hackett said, smiling. Guy talks with his fists. Back home, everyone called me Jamie, I said. trying to say something.
Yeah, great, Freddy said.
Drop those last two bags in your room, Buckeye.
He wiped a broad arc in the air.
We'll show you around.
Freddy urged me on, slapping me on the shoulder, pushing me through the dorm. He and Hackett walked down the hall, throwing those smiles, shaking hands with parents and freshmen along the way.
Welcome to Fullbrook.
They could have been running for office. Once we dumped the bags and were back outside, Freddy led us up the street between the dorms.
Girls,
he pointed.
Girls?
Boys, he grinned.
We'll get to the girls themselves later.
Cool, I said, trying to follow him. I was taking in the sweep of scenery, the narrow, zigzagging paths winding through clusters of trees, connecting one brick mansion to another. The blue day, even the watery reflections in the stained glass windows, seemed curated, cultivated, perfected. History was everywhere, looming over me like the long, leafy branches casting shadows over the walkway.
Here you're a football player.
A sliver of pain sliced through me.
Was.
Football was out. That life was over. One play, and it was as if I'd ripped a hole in the ground and pulled my whole town down into the darkness below.
I'm here for hockey.
My second sport. The one my family, Coach Drucker, and the handful of people who still talk to me back home all told me was my ticket up and out. Kid like you deserves a second chance, I'd been told.
Yeah, I know, Freddy went on. You're the new secret weapon. But this is fall. Football.
He stutter-stepped, threw a fake left, and rolled around Hackett. He got a few paces ahead of us, stopped, and turned back.
What I mean is, Coach O would give his left nut to have you on the football team. What'd you play?
Linebacker.
Damn, that's what we need, man. A defensive line, blitz pressure, sacks.
He rambled on, setting nerves on fire beneath my skin. I hadn't been on campus for an hour, and already I could hear the echoes from back home.
What the hell's the matter with you, Jamie?
Look at you. Must have racked up a hell of a hit count. We scratch ours in rows on our lockers. He bumped me with his shoulder.
Hit!
He nodded. You know what's up.
That's right. Why aren't you playing?
I searched for something that wouldn't sound as awful as the truth.
Grades.
I lied.
For real?
Freddy said.
You have to do it all here, Buckeye. Do it all. Be it all.
We crossed another street, and Hackett pointed to a tree in front of the administration building.
Oldest tree on campus, he said.
I don't know. 250 years old, something like that. He pointed to a break between branches. From where we stood, looking up, the branches perfectly framed the engraved lettering in the arch above the front door of the administration building. It was Latin, which I only guessed because of the weird V for U.
School motto?
That's right, Hackett said.
Ut parati in mundo.
Ready to take on the world, we say. He grinned at Freddy.
Are you screwing with me?
No, Freddy said. He rolled his eyes.
Yeah, it's corny as hell, Hackett continued. They'll take the whole freshman class here and show them this. They'll talk about the tree, its deep roots, its soaring branches, he said, dropping his voice cartoonishly. They'll point to the school motto and remind them what it means to join the Fullbrook legacy.
Corny, Freddy echoed.
Now, let's get to the real shit.
Ready to take on the world?
I'd seen the motto when I'd visited the previous spring. Everybody at Fullbrook seemed like a genius to me. Already worldly, already honing their special skill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.